Express yourself in the Holy Ghost.
Hallelujah. Today, as I was preparing the message, and I was struggling to do something, and I took a band. Do you see the elastic band that is here? You see it? It's elastic band. If I put it like this, and I ask, what's the use of it? Each one of us will give a use, according to what normally we use it for. So a mother would say, oh, I use it to do the hair for the babies. A cook or woman in the kitchen say, oh, I use it to cover, when I put the cover on my food, I use to cover it like this. So the cover will not move or the flies will not come. A lot of people will tell you that for many to hold the documents together, to do. Some will tell you is to take bundles of money together. She is one bundle, but it has many things. And when you see it, your mind goes straight to what you use it for. So that habit that has formed in you will dictate, I hope you understand, will dictate, is new, is a revelation. Dictate what God wants you to use that thing for. So, when God says, what do you have in your hand? He knows what you already do, what you have in your hands. Now, if we talk about fruits, for example, a lot of people, they eat the fruits and throw the seed. But people around me know that I don't throw my seed. I keep them. And why I keep them? Because I think that if God has put seed there, it means he wants us to use it. It's just seed. When you eat popo, there are hundreds of, I don't know, tens of seed. But we just eat the popo and throw in the garbage. I don't know. I went even to extreme to Google how to separate the male seed. You know, there are some trees, popo, with those flower, they don't. And I realized that the Indians has worked out. You put them in the water. When the seed goes up, is a male. That one, I disagree because I don't want. Unless you want it for medicine. He said it's very medicinal. So, but me, I want the fruit. So I plant the fruit. And I just realized, before I pray, I just want, if each one of us has eaten a popo, and while he finished popo, he goes by the street and threw the seed, we'll have thousands of popo trees all over. And we will be eating, everybody will be eating popo. You go and plug, because there are many you plug. Orange, the same thing. Any seed that you think about. And when God talks about seed, he means very, very powerful things. He means his word, the word of God. So it means that the seed is very, very important to God. So from today, let's think differently. That when we have something in our hand, let's think how to propagate it, how to put it in use. It's not like eat whatever you eat, throw whatever you throw. Think where it is in your hand that way. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we bless you. Father, we thank you for your goodness and mercy. We thank you for today, wonderful day. And we have gathered together here. You brought us not because
we had nothing to do. Oh, you have nothing to do. You brought us because you have a purpose and you have a plan. And you want us to know, to learn, all of us, including the preacher, that you want us, you want to reveal unto us things that we do not know. We are very grateful. We thank you, Father. We commit ourselves, our mind, to listen and to do what you want us to do. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Oh, I promised to send the title, I forgot. So, choosing the title is choosing God's blessings over discontentment. Choosing, we choose. Choosing God's blessings over discontentment. And we take our main scripture from Haggai chapter 2, and we start with 15, and we go Haggai chapter 15. We go chapter 2, verse 15. And the story before before we get this scripture, the story is about the Jewish people coming out of exile. 400 years of exile. And they are coming back to Jerusalem. They have already come back to Jerusalem. So Lord raised the prophet Haggai to tell them things that they were doing wrong and show them the way to do the right thing. Will you be happy? I am talking to you, congregation. Will you be happy if God uses the circumstances where we are to show us what he wants to do? And believe me, wherever God wants to do something, he knows when to do it, how to do it, and the outcome. So me, I always want God to take my circumstances, ask me to do something, and I know the outcome will be in my favor, though I will be serving his plans and his purposes. The result, as I am serving him, will be in my favor. Hallelujah. So remember that he said, I know the thoughts I have for you. You understand? He knows the thoughts he has for each one of us, no matter the circumstances, no matter how. He, all what he asks is that seek ye the kingdom first and its righteousness. All things will be added to you. Those people who seek the all things first, then they have all, everything is settled. Then they go to the church to show off with the whatever God has given them. God is interested in the people who hear his word, plant it in their life, and let the seed come out. Hallelujah. Now, when we read Haggai 2, you remember that Haggai was a prophet, and he speaks the mind of God. He brings the word of God from heaven to earth. That's the prophet. And now he's telling the Jews, and now carefully consider from this day forward, from before stones was laid upon stone in the temple of the Lord. Now Haggai is telling them, you have come back. Fine. After 400 years of exile, look at the temple. There is no temple. The temple has been destroyed. Now, before you think to put a stone upon stone, think, see. Now, verse 16 is not there. Verse 16. Verse 16. Since those days, when one came to heap of a 20 ephah, there were but 10. There were but 10. When one came to the wine press, the wine vat, the wine press, when they pressed the wine, the grapes, to draw out 50 baths from the press, there were but 20. God is telling them, look, you were supposed to have 20 ephah from a heap. You don't have. You have only half of it, 10. Then when you come to the wine press, instead having 50 baths, those big wooden containers, you have only 20. So the thing is going from half to third. Hallelujah. Then the 17 says, I smote with my, I smote you, I struck you with blight and mildew and hail in all the labor of your hand. Who did that? Give them half quarter, and he's telling them, it's not because the sun was hot or you didn't have any water or you didn't have, no, did that to you. So please, when you are in hardship, listen to me and with all humility, when you are going through hardship, lack, when you cannot eat from your labor, and the things are going, it's not only Satan who is at work. Please, always we say Satan, Satan has come, Satan has taken my money, Satan has done this. Sometimes it's God himself. And it's very hard for a newborn baby Christian to think that God can be hard. God is a judge. Hello? And the judge is supposed to be just. The judge cannot be biased. Oh, because this is a Christian, is my son, I'm going to help him. Oh, this one is not my son, I'm not. God is a judge. He judges according to our obedience, our righteousness, our obedience to his word and his commandment. So he's saying, yet you didn't turn to me. I don't know why God is bringing Haggai to 15 and going. It's with my hands. Because when you want to strike or to hit or to smite, you need your hands to use something. So God uses his strength to smite and disturb and make a basa-basa all the work of the people and the labor of the hands. So that's why I said some people work very hard, but there is nothing to show off. You have to be very careful. Turn back. Turn back and turn back many times into God and ask why I am that way. And that's why the deliverance and the teaching of our pastor Jacob comes into the picture. You cannot be roaming around and not knowing what is setting you back. That's why I say the title is that choosing God's blessing over discontentment. In Ghana, we have become experts in discontentment. Discontentment. We are unhappy about everything. There is things to be unhappy about. A lot of things to be unhappy about. But there is a choice to be made by every day. We forget that we have promised God that we will not complain, because complaining and negative complaining without repentance, without prayer, takes us to roam around in the wilderness for 40 years. Good 40 years. So he said, I know that you work because the labor of your hand. God is not saying you are lazy. But a lot of people say, Africans, we haven't prospered because we are lazy. I have never seen an European woman carrying water, carrying I don't know what on her head and sell it in the street. I haven't seen yet. I traveled Europe, I traveled America. I haven't seen a farmer taking a hoe or axe, whatever, and doing with his hand like this for the whole farm. They have machines, they have things. And that, yes, they say we are lazy. I don't agree. We have allowed others to put us in this situation, and on the top of that, criticize us. God will awaken us up and put us on that to choose His blessings. Then the discontentment and the complaining. He said, the labor of your hand, yet you didn't turn to me. The sad thing is that God is showing us, I have put everything that pertains to life, and life, abundant life, not only like small, small life. I have given you things that when you see them, like people see this band, elastic band, they will know that is for money. Bundles of money. Not for the hair of the children. I can buy nicer one than this for my hair. But it's for money, to burn money, because it's small, you see. It's not big. Maybe hundreds, thousands of dollars or euros, whatever. So God has, He's telling us, like in the time of Haggai, and the picture is exactly the same. I have smite you, I have struck you, and yet you didn't turn to me. Do you know that a lot of people are in the church? Hallelujah. But they are not of the church. Let me just go. You are welcome. So, if you are seated in a church and the word of God is preached, it means that there is a seed coming from above. Because the word of God is the seed that God plants in somebody's heart's life. If you are seated in a church, the word of God comes week after week, but you continue doing what you are doing week after week, God will say, and I struck you with blight, mildew, and hail from above. You know, hail is like the big snow. It's a ball of white snow. When it hits a car, hail. It can break the screen, window screen. So it's very, very. So he said, and I spoiled the labor of your hands. Like I said, we worked so hard. You see the woman with the children at the back, carrying I don't know what. Then there was another child that she's holding by the hand. The other hand is holding whatever it is. And the labor, when she comes home, she will come the next day doing this, the next day doing that, the next day doing that, without coming back and asking what's happening. And not only about people, individuals, but economies of countries. When Africa is blessed with everything, when I say everything, I mean everything. Whatever lacking is in America is in here. Whatever is lacking in Europe is here. Even our brains. And yet, we don't have anything to show off. Why? Because we haven't returned to the Lord. When I say return, as Africans, we should now believe only way forward for us and for the generations to come is God. Only God has the solution for Ghana, for Africa, in his hand. Don't look at the people above there. The majority of them, all over, from the north to the south, east, west, they have chosen to serve Mammon. When you serve Mammon, your heart becomes very hard, like Satan's heart. Then we shouldn't look up to them for blessings or for anything. We need to make, I'm speaking very slowly so we can get it. We need to make the choice. I choose God's blessings. And I want God to bless the labor of my hand. You remember in the Bible, he said, I will bless the work of your hands. In Deuteronomy, I think. He said, God said, I will bless the work of your hand. Now, there are conditions. That's why you see in the kingdom of God, there are some people who are blessed. There are some people who are yet to be blessed. But there is always the seed, the word of God, that says that, turn to me. You see? this word in this scripture, yet, this word is like but, is yet. Three letter words. It's very, very important in this scripture. God is saying, I did everything bad to you. Listen to me. What I'm saying with all humility. I did all the things bad to quicken you, to shake you, and yet you didn't turn to me. And that yet means that no matter what happens to you, you are enslaved. Because these people are just came from slavery. Remember? The Africans, where we came from. Colonialism. We were slaves, basically. Whatever they decide there in Europe, in Berlin, 1984, is still happening to us today. And yet, we haven't turned to God. If the people that God chose to put on as our leaders since independence, if they have turned to God, some of them tried, but they couldn't. They couldn't follow. If they have, by now, we will be the Europeans, the Americans, the whosoever, Australians, who say will be begging us for wheat, for gas, for everything. I told you, even for ourselves. Please, can you come? Let your youth come and help us. Hallelujah. Now, they don't ask you, let them help us. They tell you, we give you 1,000 for a nest and send the nest to us. $1,000, 1,000 pounds? 1,000 pounds. That nest has been through schooling in the government. By our taxes, it's not 1,000 pounds that it took her to become a nurse. And yet, they are still doing the same thing. And we are still doing the same thing, expecting different results. That is insanity. Madness. And yet, we haven't turned to the Lord. Don't think that because you go to a church and he's full up with people who are dancing, who are clapping, who are, I don't know when. And you say, oh, God is here. I bet you there are mega churches where God has gone far away. No, I'm not. I'm just talking what the Holy Spirit is telling me. They are far away from God. And yet, followers are there. You see somebody who is obviously and godly, and you still go to church. I mean, bewitched. We are bewitched Christians. They have bewitched us, and we are sitting there. The only thing that we do is like robots, like zombies. We come and we go. We don't change. We change for the worse. May God have mercy upon us. May God have mercy upon the Africans. May God have mercy upon all His children, the Christians. In Jesus' name, hallelujah. I want us to say that God has delivered this message. It's a very hard message to the Jewish people. The Jewish people, they love their God. And they said they are going to build the temple. God said, before you put one stone in, come and see me. Because you see, you can build a church, but without God's anointing, unction, and the presence, you will not reach the plan, the purposes of God for the life of the people that He brought to the church. So God used Haggai, the prophet, to deliver the message to the Jewish people. You have come from slavery. You have come from colonialism. You have come from places where you had no way to say, whatever the master says you do, he said, it's over. Turn to me because I am the master. When God says, turn to me, he is your master. You have no choice. Otherwise, you continue living in darkness. I want to go to 19. We can read 18 and 19. But I want to look at the verse 19. God is asking a question. Look at the question that God is asking. Well, he told them, first, you haven't turned to me back. You haven't. Don't put a stone over a stone and say that's the temple of God. Don't. Now in 19, he said, is the seed still in the barn? It's a very important question. God is asking, do you have any seed left of what I went with you all these years? I delivered you all this time. You are sitting here. God delivered the majority of us from certain death. Say amen. Me, I'm the first. God wanted us to live and do His work, no matter in what position or how. God has His own plan and purposes. Whatever He does it in order to elevate us. We are very stubborn and we are being bewitched. So we read the word of God and we brush it and we continue doing what we are doing. If we are lying, we lie. If we are fornicating, we fornicate. If we are stealing, we continue stealing. If we are betting and doing lotto, I know, we continue doing it. And yet we come to church. Hallelujah. God say, hello who? God is angry. I can't carry God's anger. I can't. So, you see, you have seed still in the barn. As yet, the vine, God is saying all the things. As the vine, the grapes, the vine. Me, I know all these trees because they grow in my country. And we love all the fruit of this. We love them. I'm trying to replicate them in my garden. So difficult. The climate is different. So he said, the vine, the fig tree. I have the vine in my house. I have the fig tree in my house. The pomegranate I have in my house. Not doing well, but it's there. Produced three fruits since I brought it. He said, and the olive tree I have not yielded fruits. He's asking us, is there any seed in the barn? The barn, do you know the barn? The barn is the barn is where we stock the beans and fruits and whatever we have for the next season or as we are eating. So he's asking the Jewish people and asking us, is there any seed in the barn, Haggai 2:19. If we have seed in the barn, small word of God that is stuck to you from any preaching, from any place, it's time to put it into the soil to grow and bring fruit. Hallelujah. God is saying, don't leave the things, the seed that he has deposited in you, don't let them dormant. You see, a lot of people need the word of God to be preached. A lot. And the word of God, we say, is the seed. So when you plant the seed, the word of God, in somebody's heart, you move. God works in the person. In the person's heart. The only thing that God requires is an obedient and open heart. All what he thinks. Then when you receive Jesus Christ as seed, you let it grow. Go read the Bible. Let the join groups, join church where the word of God is preached, and that seed will grow. Hallelujah. Now, when he said, but, see, yet and but, two little words, this but. This but changes all this. So all what God said, that the seed is still in the barn. You have done nothing. Me too. I haven't given you any fruit in your barn. But from this day. So when the Bible says, those who have ears, let them hear, is this. You haven't turned to me. Jesus said it in 16. Now, 16. And 17, 18, 19, God changes your story. He changes the negative narrative about you into a positive one, and not by anything, only by obedience. When God said obedience is better than sacrifice, we just say it. Obedience is better than sacrifice. Yeah, sacrifice is good. Obedience is better. Because when you turn to him, but from this day, I will bless you. Hallelujah. Now, if we are discouraged, but what we see in Africa, in Ghana, in our family, poverty, lack of marriage, lack of, lack of what? Progress, ungodliness everywhere. People are stealing, corruption. Guess what God is required of his children? And we turn back. He said, ask. God is not telling you go to the mountain of Zerubbabel or go to Jerusalem or take an airplane and go to Dubai and I will see you there. He said, ask and I will answer you. Ask. God said, ask me. I mean, when you read this and you know who is asking you to ask him, is God Almighty, the creator of the heavens and earth. And you need to make some sense in our heads that the God Almighty is giving us permission to ask of him. He said, and I will answer you. You go and ask somebody there, a minister of state, will not even dare to listen to you. You'll not even find him to ask him. When he's on the car, we are supposed to disappear from the road. I don't know how. There are four roads. There is no special place for ambulance, for whatever it is. But still, they want you to, I don't know how to create time. Sometimes I wonder, this guy who is blowing his horn behind me, is he normal? Why should I? I should make James Bond or whatever. So you don't find them to ask them questions about what is this and what I should do, what I did. You don't find them. But the one who created them, the one who created the universe, is there waiting for you to come and sit down, kneel down and say, don't even kneel down. Just sit down with your heart open, with your obedience ready to hear what he says and do it. And he said, ask me and I will answer you and I will show you things that you do not know. It's the call. Jeremiah 33 verse 3. They call it the red phone. Red, you call God and he will answer. How many times looking at your situation that your vine is not producing fruit, your things is not happening, your work is not coming, your ministry is not growing, your marriage is trembling, whatever. Have you sat down and called upon the Lord Almighty instead of complaining? When I see, I don't understand you. I hear the people in the radio. I think they are fighting. Then I ask, are they fighting? They say, no, they are not fighting, they are talking. I said, they are like one-to-one, like less than 50 centimeters. But the sound is, I say, what are they saying? They're saying that the politics is no good, the weather is no good. Not only they are complaining, but they are making noise that is to themselves, that is very harmful to their ears and to their minds. Where they are going to go? Nowhere. Still doing all this, we should turn to him. The prophet has said it. And why I look at this picture as where we are here is like exactly historically we can put the Jewish in Jerusalem and put ourselves in Accra. What are we benefiting from where God has given to us? Anybody here benefiting from oil, from gas, from gold? When you need school for your children in the countryside, in the village, there is no school in the village. They are under the tree. And somebody is hoarding millions of dollars in his bedroom. Doesn't know even how much have been stolen. That's why God said, those who know me, turn to me. And I will. Now, I'm going to just do some maybe conclusion and I will finish. Because when God speaks, he means every word he says. In the book of Revelation, there is a verse that said, cast anybody who will take one word from this book or add one word. Hallelujah. God's word is so important to him because he himself is the word. So it's very important to keep the word of God as it is. But you need to apply it to your life. So when I say, do you want to be prosperous? Everybody wants to be. Do you want power? everybody want power, including myself. Do you want money? Yes, I want. Do you want good health? Yes, I want. Do you? All is in the Word of God. It takes the seven spirits of the Lord, and I teach you all the time. You need those spirits to be ministering to you. But before they minister to you, God needs you to be obedient to the outcome. When God says, let the seven spirits of the Lord be upon him, the spirit of knowledge, you need to know. You need to read the word. You need to absorb that word. You cannot be prosperous if you don't know the key that be used to open the treasures. So the treasures will be there, and the key is here, but your eyes are closed because you don't know. That's why God, the seven spirit, knowledge. You need to know what God has put in his word in order to use it in obedience, in righteousness, and benefit from what he has put. I'm saying it very simple. I can't be even simpler than that. Now, when you know what to use and how to use it, you will enter that strong room and get what God has, because every one of us, God has something in store. Some can catch it, some they go to heaven and God says, he said, oh God, I prayed, I did, and then I have never seen the good thing. Say, me when I sent you that message in the church, did you obey? Did you do the word? When we read the declaration every Sunday, did you listen to the word that are in the declaration? Do you come close to the word of God? Do you do the things? Do you fellowship with God? Now, we cannot be, because we are Christians, God will pour money. No, no. You need to do what is right in his eyes. That's why he told the Jewish in Haggai that do not put a stone on it. Because when you put a stone upon a stone, you build the temple. That temple will be empty. There will be no my presence. When you go to a church and they are preaching all kinds of things, not the word of God, God is not there. Believe me. I can hear too the message, the whole thing. And I see like, I'm just waiting when I can feel or I can see or I can read the presence of God. Jesus Christ is the word of God. And if the word of God has put flesh in him and came to earth, that flesh, that word is very important. God said, I love the world so much that I gave my only begotten son. So whosoever believe in him will have eternal life. God is saying, I took my word, my precious word, I put flesh on it, and I send it to you so you can have eternal life. What did you do with my son Jesus Christ? Crucified him, pretend you believe in him, and you live your life according to your pleasures. Yet God said, turn to me, I will forgive you, and I will bless you. I will make your vine produce grapes, your olive tree produce olives and oil. Hallelujah. Now your barn, whatever the seed you have, plant it, I will water it. Hallelujah. Now, there was a question, we said, what is in the barn? But in 19, he said, he finished the verse 19 with a promise. So from a question to a promise. No master on this earth will do that. You have heard the politicians. We will build schools. We will build what? Roads. We will do dams. We will bring heaven on earth. I will build a bridge. He said, politician is doing his campaign and is in the middle of a desert place. And he said, and I will build you a bridge. And his counselor, whatever, he said, hey, master, there is no river here. And I'll bring you river. And people clap. River. Maybe you are in Saudi Arabia, and I don't know. In Ghana, we haven't river like that. Hallelujah. God starts with the question in the same verse. Why the question? When I'm a teacher, my profession. When I ask a question, what I expect? What do I expect? God knows that unless you do what he requires of you in obedience, but from this day, I will bless you. He started with the question and said, okay, between this and this, just return to me, and I will bless you from this day. May this promise of God be part and parcel of our lives as we obey and follow the prompting of the Holy Spirit. There is nothing more important to have God in our lives, to have the hand of God upon us. You can have all the riches of the world. If you don't have God, you cannot be fulfilled. I lived in the world. I had everything in the world. I was not fulfilled. I came to Christ Jesus. Whatever I have is enough for me, because he is my provider. And I sleep in peace. People say, oh, take tablets, monsieur, please give me a bed and pillow. I don't worry about anything. I sleep, because what I do during the day, I think is righteous. Sometimes it's mistakes, but we are just human. But stealing, doing things that you repent, you sleep like a baby. Don't need any tablet. But when you steal people's money and put it in your bedroom, you'll be having nightmares. Because those children without tables, they are following you. Those widows without money, they are following you. In your dream, even dogs, wild dogs will be following you. So people should be very, very mindful of God's love. If you understand the deepest of his love, you will not be worried about what you will eat. Because God says the sparrow, Psalm 84, he said that the sparrow is the smallest bird. It's very bad. I saw it in France, but I didn't. It's small, maybe small, and it doesn't stop when it's flying. It doesn't stop flying. Even that small bird, God said, I have provided for that sparrow. What about you? You are 100 times or maybe more bigger than the sparrow, and you are a child of God. So today, if you have Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, expect God to do the last things. From this day on, I will bless you. And that's the promise of God. And the promise of God is yes and amen. Hallelujah.